Good morning.
Good morning.
I'd like to welcome you all to our service today. It's so good to be together. Seeing some faces of folks who have been away for a few weeks who are back, it's so good to be with you. And of course, it's summertime, so a lot of Hopwood folks are out to the four winds, but it's so good to be together this morning. Also, congratulations. It's only the second week of the summer schedule, and you all found the right time and the right place. So this is amazing. So this is great. When people come through in about, a half hour or so, just nod and realize that they're figuring it out. So it'll be okay. Today our scriptures are kind of all pointing us in the direction of thinking about two things. One, we're all kind of messed up. Two, God is completely unintimidated by that. And in fact, loves to hang out with people who are messed up. So that's good news. And we'll think about that as we read the scriptures, as we sing, and as we listen for God's Spirit. Let's come together with a lot of joy as we gather to worship today.
Our call to worship song is in your order of worship. Alleluia, for the Lord God Almighty reigns. The first two lines are repeated, so we sing through that twice, then sing to the bottom, then we'll do the whole thing again. Following that, we'll open in our hymnals to number 78 and sing, O God, our help in ages past. As we praise God, if you're able, let's stand together and sing.
For the Lord God Almighty reigns. 78. Oh God, how help in ages past, our hope for years to come, our shelter from the stormy blast, and our
together. Lord, we bless you this morning, thanking you for the fact that you are God of the universe, creator of all. We place ourselves under your care. We thank you for your mighty love. We appreciate so much how you have reached out to people who are in trouble, people who struggle, people who sin, people who just can't get it right. We bless you, Lord, that those are your favorite folks. We bless you because we are those people. And we thank you for being present in our midst. We thank you, Lord, for sending Jesus Christ to us. We thank you for everything he taught us. We thank you for his sacrificial death, and for his mighty transforming resurrection. Be present in our midst as we worship you today, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Please be seated. Let's listen now to the word of the Lord.
Our first reading is from Genesis 12, 1 through 9. Now the Lord said to Abram, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to the land that I will show you. I will make of you a great nation, and I will bless you, and make your name great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and the one who curses you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth shall be blessed." So Abram went, as the Lord had told him, and Lot went with him. Abram was 75 years old when he departed from Haran. Abram took his wife Sarai and his brother's son Lot and all the possessions that they had gathered and the persons whom they had acquired in Haran, and they set forth to go to the land of Canaan. When they had come to the land of Canaan, Abram passed through the land to the place at Shechem, to the oak of Moreh. At the time, the Canaanites were in the land. Then the Lord appeared to Abram and said, "To your offspring I will give this land." So he built there an altar to the Lord who had appeared to him. From there he moved on to the hill country on the east of Bethel and pitched his tent, with Bethel on the west and Ai on the east. And there he built an altar to the Lord and invoked the name of the Lord. And Abram journeyed on by stages toward the Negev. The word of the Lord.
Blessed the people the Lord has chosen, chosen to be his own. Blessed the people the Lord has chosen, chosen to be his own. Blessed the nation whose God is the Lord, the people he has chosen as his heritage. From the heavens the Lord looks for, he sees all the children of men. Blessed the people the Lord has chosen, chosen to be his own. From the just place where he dwells, he gazes on all the dwellers of the earth. He who shapes the hearts of them all and considers all their deeds. Blessed the people the Lord hath chosen, chosen to be his own. Our soul is waiting for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. In him do our hearts find joy. We trust in his holy name. May your merciful love be upon us as we hope in you, O Lord. Blessed the people the Lord hath chosen, chosen to be.
Our second reading comes from Romans chapter 4, verses 13 through 25. For the promise that he would inherit the world did not come to Abraham or to his descendants through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. If it is the adherents of the law who are to be the heirs, faith is null and the promise is void. For the law brings wrath, but where there is no law, neither is there violation. For this reason, it depends on faith, in order that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all his descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham. For he is the father of all of us, as it is written, I have made you the father of many nations. In the presence of the God in whom he believed, who gives life to the dead and calls into existence the things that do not exist. Hoping against hope, he believed that he would become the father of many nations, according to what was said, so numerous shall your descendants be. He did not weaken in faith when he considered his own body, which was already as good as dead, for he was about 100 years old, or when he considered the barrenness of Sarah's womb. No distrust made him waver concerning the promise of God. But he grew strong in his faith as he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words, it was reckoned to him, were written not for his sake alone, but for ours also. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses, and was raised for our justification. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We should take your order of worship one more time. As we come together to pray, we're going to sing, O Christ, the Healer, we have come.
Let's take just a couple moments to talk over some of our needs and requests, and let's also call out some of our joys and some of the wonderful ways that God has blessed us. Who would like to start us out? Let's start out with our thanksgivings and joys. Let's just name a few of them as we gather. Yes, Mary? Wow, fantastic. Yes.
The Peltons are coming this summer, so I'm pretty excited. We haven't seen them for about 4 years.
That's exciting. For those of you that don't know, these folks minister in China. And so the eldest daughter, Loria, came to Milligan this year, but it'd be great to see the rest of them. Ted? Right. Praise the Lord. Other blessings and goodness. Joe.
My older daughter's son, Andy Taylor, Yara Holmes, graduated from high school, and his mother and father took him on a private senior trip to the Caribbean.
Okay, fantastic. Yes, Sibley?
I noticed that the fireflies are back, and it's my second time seeing fireflies.
Fantastic. Firefly season. And I don't know if you've seen the synchronous ones, but that'll blow your mind. Yeah. Yeah. Somebody else? Yes. Wonderful. It's so good to have you. Aaron's mom's here with us and brother.
We have two more great grandchildren that's on the way.
Praise God. Yes, Miriam.
About 4 years ago this time, the church gathered around Michael and I and prayed a blessing over us. And it's been a beautiful 4 years. And we thank the church for the little support.
4 years. Wow, okay. And how about needs? And let's call out some of our needs and requests. Martha's struggling. Martha Veter, I know, and with her health. Sarah Ruth Moore is struggling as well at the Hillside in Elizabethton. Linda Yarwood has had very serious surgery, and she's just getting ready to go to rehab. Jim Dahlman had good news from that checked out your heart and getting ready for knee surgery. So we'll pray for you, Jim. And Rosemary and Mel, I understand Rosemary had a fall and a bump. So let's pray for her. Other situations you'd like to make known? Yes. Let's go to God in prayer, shall we? Lord, we praise you and thank you, for you are the God who is present. We read this morning how you came to Abram so many years ago. You decided to make yourself known to him, to them, and through them to bless all the people on earth. We thank you that you've come to us, that you have lived among us. We thank you that you sent Jesus to us to sound the depths of the joys and the goodness of being on earth and walking this planet. to bear the sorrows and troubles of a race that's gone crazy. We bless you that you did not turn away from any of it. And Lord, with great hope, we place ourselves before you today, asking you to continue to dwell with us. We ask you to continue, Lord, to call us, to speak with us, to lead us. We thank you for the joys that we have experienced. Wonderful things like being married 4 years or 64 years. Wonderful things like experiencing the good news of a test that's gone well. Wonderful news of family members being reunited. And Lord, we thank you that you are the kind of God and we are the kind of fellowship where we can share our deep needs and struggles and troubles. We ask, O Lord, that you would bless these people that whose names we have called. And we pray, Lord, that you would be present in every situation where there is sickness and brokenness and trouble and sin. We thank you, Lord, for the children of this congregation. We bless them and we ask God that you would help them as they're growing. Evan's got a birthday. We thank you for him. We thank you, Lord, for kids who are growing up to know you. We thank you for all of our teachers and leaders. We thank you for this summer season. We're such an amazing part of the world in which we live. The mountains are so beautiful. They're filled with trees and fruit, and gardens that are blossoming, and even fireflies. It's such a wondrous place. And all of creation sings out your name. Speak to us today, O Lord, so that like Abraham, we might learn that this life is not about living it all perfectly, coloring inside the lines, but it's about putting our faith and trust in you. Bless us. Forgive us, O Lord, when we fail. Walk with us. And by the presence of Christ, bring us home. We pray all these things in the name of our Savior, Jesus, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Let's all stand together as we listen to the gospel.
Our gospel text is from Matthew chapter 9. As Jesus was walking along, he saw a man called Matthew sitting at the tax booth, and he said to him, "Follow me." And he got up and followed him. And as he sat at dinner in the house, many tax collectors and sinners came and were sitting with him and his disciples. When the Pharisees saw this, they said to his disciples, "Why does your teacher eat with tax collectors and sinners?" But when he heard this, he said, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. "For I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners." While he was saying these things to them, suddenly a leader of the synagogue came in and knelt before him, saying, "My daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her, and she will live." And Jesus got up and followed him with his disciples. Then suddenly a woman who had been suffering from hemorrhages for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his cloak, for she said to herself, "If I only touch his cloak, I will be made well." Jesus turned, and seeing her, he said, "Take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well." And instantly the woman was made well. When Jesus came to the leader's house and saw the flute players and the crowd making a commotion, he said, "Go away, for the girl is not dead, but sleeping." And they laughed at him. But when the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took her by the hand, and the girl got up. And the report of this spread throughout that district. The word of the Lord.
Take your order of worship again. As we come to the table together, we're going to sing, "There's a Wideness in God's Mercy."
There's a wideness in your mercy, like the wideness of the sea. There's a kindness in your justice, which is more than liberty. There is welcome for the sinner, and more graces for the good. There is mercy with you, Savior. There is healing in your blood. There's a vastness in your mercy, like the vastness of the sky. Your intentions toward your people show your grace supremely high. For your love, O God, is broader than the measure of our mind. And your heart, Almighty Father, is most wonderfully
common assumption in our culture is that science is solid, but faith is not. With science, you can know if knowledge has been obtained by the scientific method, and that knowledge is reliable and true. You can speak of such knowledge with others, knowing it's been obtained by a respectable, universally accepted method. But in that same worldview, faith is individual. Subjectively apprehended. It's something you might experience and believe yourself, but you kind of violate the rules of appropriate public discourse if you speak as though your experience were automatically applicable to others. Today's scripture passages hold up Abram as a highly valued example of living the way God wants us to live. But Abram didn't build walls between his own internal ideas about who God is and his impact on others. God's command on Abram meant that all of his household would be going where Abram went. And God said that others would be blessed or cursed depending on how they treated Abram. And the craziest thing was God saying that the entire world would be blessed through Abram. Abram's faith and the actions he took on the basis of that faith had very serious and universal consequences, even though no scientist at the time could have measured God's command or used materialistic theories to predict the effect on the world, on us here today, of Abram's decisions. But that's okay, Science, as it turns out, isn't supposed to give you eternal knowledge. At its best, it tells you what we've figured out so far. In contrast to the ever-changing nature of science, having faith in Christ is grounding yourself on someone who is unchanging, the solid bedrock we build upon. Faith in God is not blindly checking your brain at the door and thoughtlessly obeying a book or dogmatic reverends in robes. Faith is extrapolated evidence. But its evidence is not just physical, limited to the scientific realms. It's broader, fuller, and deeper. As Frederick Buechner put it, you get to listen to your life, all of your life, with every bit of both understanding and experience, knowing that there is an eternal, unchanging, reliable, trustworthy person behind it all who is meeting you. Your life is built on the unknowable, infinite mystery of the living God, who nonetheless revealed himself to Abram and then revealed himself perfectly to the world, to all people, in his Son, Jesus Christ. Jesus gave us this table. The mystery is here. Common food, bread and juice, that in the words of Jesus are his body and blood. You could run experiments on these elements all day long and learn nothing else about God, but we are called to be open to the totality of our understanding and experience, to gather personal proof and to put greater trust in the person of God than in the ever-shifting understandings of science. It is through that trust that, like Abraham, we are called. But this is what the Lord himself said, and I pass it on to you just as I received it. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant between God and you, sealed by the shedding of my blood. Do this in remembrance of me as often as you drink it." For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until Jesus comes again.
Thank you.
Trust with your money. Who do you trust with God's money? Because your money is really just God's. I have no reason to distrust Hopwood with my tithe. But even if doubts were to wiggle into my thoughts, my first refuge is my trust in God. He provided the money in the first place. He called us here. We're responsible for how we steward God's resources, but we needn't drown in anxiety about it. Give generously, in faith, trusting that your Father will provide for you.
Thank you.
kingdom here in Hopwood and throughout the world. But we pray too, Lord, that you bless the giver. And we pray, God, in this new week that we would walk and be a blessing to someone along our way. For it's in Jesus' name.
Denton Cruz graduated from David Lipscomb College in Nashville and was called to minister at a church that he'd come from in the Brookline, Massachusetts Church of Christ. Finding himself in the pulpit of one of the most historic Restoration Movement churches in New England was a little bit daunting for him. And Cruz was understandably intimidated by the presence of, well, as Pat Hardy calls them, the rocket scientists, folks from MIT, Tufts, Boston U, those kinds of folks. He was especially skittish by a group of seminarians from Harvard Divinity School who were in the congregation. Feeling like maybe he was in over his head, Cruz called a colleague, Abe Mallerby, a Harvard Divinity School student who was preaching at a neighborhood Church of Christ. He asked Mallerby, "What do I say to these people?" Mallerby said, "Tell them they're sinners. Tell them they're sinners. Hey, y'all, you're sinners." Takes care of that, I guess. How do you hear that message? How does it sit with you? Tell them they're sinners. Tell us we are sinners. If that was a statement that was laid upon us to grind us down, to cause people to be in fear of God, I think I'd probably have objections to raise. But if it is an acknowledgement that we all struggle, that we all have feet of clay, that we're all imperfect people struggling to get through this world, I think then it's a good, true reminder of our humanity. Tell them that they're sinners. I will, but that's not the whole message. If I might add something to Mallerby's good advice, I would say, tell them that they're sinners and remind them that God loves sinners. That's the message I think that our scriptures bring us today. Genesis chapter 12. Tells the story of how God chose to put the world back together. He started small. He picked out one man out of all the people on earth. He didn't look for the wisest person that he could find. He didn't pick out the most famous. He didn't pick out the guy who was the mightiest or the richest. He didn't even look for the most pious, holy person he could find. God found a guy, Abram, in a town in southern Iraq, of all places. And he said to him, "Go from your country and your kindred and your father's house to a land that I will show you. And there I will make of you a great nation. And I will bless you, and your name will be great, so that you will be a blessing. I will bless those who bless you, and those who curse you, I will curse. And in you, all the families of the earth will be blessed." And so began a relationship that would have worldwide impact, undeniable worldwide impact. To this one man, Abram, all the Jewish people in the world, all the Muslim people in the world, and all the Christians in the world trace their ancestry. In you, all the families of the earth will be blessed. God told Abram to leave his home, not sharing with him the final destination, only saying, I'll let you know. We'll do it one step at a time. So Abram took off, first to Egypt, with his wife, Sarai, as if to underscore the fact that Abram was no saint, that he was weak and frail and just a regular guy. He immediately got himself and his wife into deep trouble. As they prepared to enter Egypt, Abram worried that the Egyptians would probably take a shine to his very attractive wife and might be willing to cut his throat to get her. So he made up a lie. He said, let's tell people that you're really my sister. Sarai's beauty was absolutely noticed when they went into Egypt. And in no time, she was singled out to be in the king's harem. What kind of a bum would stay silent and allow some government official to carry off his wife, I wonder? And to make matters worse, Abram profited off of the deal. The text says, for her sake, Pharaoh dealt well with Abram, and he had sheep, oxen, donkeys, male and female slaves, female donkeys, and camels. Pharaoh took Sarai as his wife, and it was only when God intervened by punishing Pharaoh with plagues and disease that he figured out Abram's little scheme. Why did you do this knuckleheaded thing? Pharaoh asked Abram. Take your wife and get out of here. So on he went, God's chosen hero and his sister and his sister slash wife. I hope Sarai made him sleep in the wagon for a long time. Later on, Abram and Sarah moved out to the Negev. And what do you know? Abraham pulled the same stunt as he pulled before, telling people that Sarah was his sister. And again, God intervened and pulled them out of a jam at the last moment. Abraham was the father, is the father of many nations. God picked him out for special favor. I get that. But he was a guy who had issues. I see that as well. He was prone to fear. He was prone to making mistakes. Abraham was a sinner. But God loved him anyway. And God was faithful to the promises that he made to Abraham. And God blessed Abraham and Sarah. He worked with them. He worked around their disbelief. He watched over them. He made them a part of his family. And he blessed them. And through Abraham, he blessed each one of us who is here today. He made Abraham a blessing for everyone on earth. And that's the way it happens with us as well. We're all sinners. We all fall off the wagon. We all make the same mistakes over and over again. But here's the news. God loves us sinners. And he calls us to believe and to belong, to pick ourselves back up, to get back on the track. Our gospel scripture tells the same story. Matthew was a tax collector for the Roman overlords. You think it's only Carter Countyans who hate higher taxes? Imagine what it would be like if, say, oh, I don't know, Russia or China took over our United States and began to collect taxes on Carter Countyans so that they could do whatever they wanted to with our hard-earned shekels. How popular do you think those kinds of tax collectors would be? That's what Matthew was. That's what Matthew did for the Romans. Back in Matthew's day, those guys who were tax collectors also got a cut of the action. And so it was no surprise that their neighbors hated these guys who profited so handsomely off of the system. Imagine the day when Jesus rolled into town. There was Matthew in his office, counting out the moolah, protected by and kowtowing to the hated Romans. And of all the people in that town that Jesus could have noticed, of all the people that Jesus might have stopped and talked to and shown an interest in, Jesus stopped in front of Matthew's place. We can almost see him just pausing, stopping, coming to attention with his eye fixed on Matthew. And we can almost hear the wheels turning in everybody else's heads. Oh, wait for this. This is going to be good. Jesus is getting ready to let that tax man have it. What do you think the man of God is going to say to this man, the traitor of our nation, this guy who's got dirty hands and a polluted heart? Well, it turns out that Jesus only had two words to say to that man. "Follow me," he said. And what a commotion it must have been as Matthew stood up and joined the little band that was following along in Jesus' wake. Like Abraham, Matthew had no idea where he was going next. Like Abraham, Matthew wasn't a perfect man. He wasn't even a good man. Most likely, he was a bad man, maybe even a notorious man, an avaricious man, a man who loved money. Kind of like, oh, I don't know, a lot of us, I guess. A man not unlike ourselves, a sinner. The Pharisees could not believe their eyes and ears. They asked the disciples, "What is up with your teacher that he eats with tax collectors and sinners?" And what could the disciples say? Well, what you see right there, that's him. That's the way he acts. That's his MO for whatever reason. He loves sinners. He loves tax collectors. He loves prostitutes. He loves people with problems. He calls them. He calls us to follow, to belong. And that night, Jesus kind of summed up that MO by saying, "You know, folks who are healthy don't really need a doctor. but sick people do. So go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I have come to call not the righteous, but sinners. Jesus told them they were sinners. And he said, I've come for you. He told them they were afflicted with deep sickness. And he also said, have no fear, the doctor is in. Our third reading from Romans 4 shares the good news that God loves not only sinners like Abraham, not only sinners like Matthew the tax man, but he loves sinners like you and sinners like me. In this passage, Paul says, look, Abraham didn't become a favorite of God because he was a righteous guy who kept all the rules. If coloring within the lines is enough to save you, faith is null and the promise is void. No, Paul said. He said that God accepts people on the basis of faith, not performance. In order, said Paul, that the promise may rest on grace and be guaranteed to all of Abraham's descendants, not only to the adherents of the law, but also to those who share the faith of Abraham, for he is the father of all of us, said Paul. Did you notice Paul's shift from the third person to the first person? From he to us. Abraham believed God's promises. He believed that he would become the father of many nations, even though he didn't have any kids, even though his wife was old. Paul says he gave glory to God, being fully convinced that God was able to do what he had promised. Therefore, his faith was reckoned to him as righteousness. Now the words, said Paul, it was reckoned to him, were written, and not for his sake alone, but for ours as well. There's that first person again. It will be reckoned to us who believe in him, who raised Jesus, our Lord, from the dead, who was handed over to death for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. Like the Brookline Church, our congregation is full of smart, high-achieving people. Like Jewish society in the time of Jesus, this room too is full of people who have had a long association with the God of Israel. We consider ourselves really insiders. We are practitioners. We like to think of ourselves as well people, not sick people. Sometimes we preachers who come before you week after week wonder, what in the world do I have to say to these people this week that they don't already know? So maybe the best that we can do is simply to speak out the gospel. We're sinners. Our goodness is not going to get us very far. Our knowledge is not going to save us. Growing up in a church is not going to save us. Reading Greek and Hebrew don't count for very much. We can't help enough people or do enough good to earn a place at God's table, to find a place in God's family. But the wonderful news is that God loves sinners and that he sent our Lord Jesus to show us the depths of his love, to do for us what we can't do for ourselves. As Paul said, Jesus was even handed over to death for our trespasses and was raised for our justification. Rachel Held Evans once said, this is her birthday, by the way. She said, this is what God's kingdom is like. A bunch of outcasts and oddballs gathered at a table, not because they're rich or worthy or good, but because they're hungry. And because they said yes, and there's always room for more. What God wants from us is for us simply, like Matthew, to say yes, like Abraham, to believe in him, to put our faith in him, enough to go forth, not knowing where we're going, not knowing what the end is going to be, to admit our helpless predicament, to see ourselves as sinners in need of a Savior rather than as insiders who have got it all figured out, and to believe in the Son who came to set us free. Like Matthew, we are called to stand when Jesus calls our name and to set our feet in motion when Jesus says, time to go, follow me. Jesus calls for us to believe, to confess Jesus as the Lord of our lives, to grieve our sins and to turn away from them in repentance, to let Jesus wash away our sins in the waters of baptism, and to be empowered as we rise in the goodness and the presence of God's Holy Spirit, joining God in the work that he's doing as he puts the world back together. Is there someone here among us who has yet to make Jesus the Lord of life? Is there someone here who has yet to ask Jesus to come near, to heal you from your sin, to love you back to reality, to wash your soul clean, to give you a new family? If that's the path you want to find, won't you step forward and make that known? Won't you say, as we've all said, I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. To say, I want him as the Lord of my life, and I want all of you to be my family. We're going to sing a hymn of response, number 580. Jesus calls us. And if you sense that Jesus is coming close to you, drawing you near, won't you step forward and meet him? Let's stand together and sing.
Shine.
me share just a couple of announcements with you as we wrap things up. We're going to do some fun things today, and hope you can be a part of it. Our summer night fellowships are beginning. We're going to be meeting tonight at the West House. The address is in the bulletin, and we'd love to see you there.
Tim?
Yeah, is there a time on that?
5:30.
Okay.
As some of you know, rain is always in the possibility, and so last week we cut our thing short. Tonight at by 4:30, if it looks threatening, we can't meet outside of the West, I will send an email to the Hopwood List, and we'll meet in the basement here because it's Evan's birthday, and there's a whole lot of cake that needs to get eaten.
Evan can't do it alone, folks. Needs our help. All right. Notice, too, there's a congregational meeting coming up 2 weeks from today. And that's a meeting to vote on the budget. We go on a July to June budget. If you want to see copies of that, there are copies on the little table outside. And we'll be voting on our new elders and deacons as well. And you'll see, I think you'll see that list.
We've
published it. Okay, it's here in the bulletin. Great. All right. Any other announcements that need to be made?
There are a few things from the potluck at our house this week, a beautiful bamboo bowl and some pot holders. If you left something at our house, come to see me at your church.
That was a great bash. Thanks for hosting us. Oh, one other thing I do need to say. It had been scheduled to place James's ashes in the columbarium over at Emmanuel on Tuesday, but some family members were not able to travel at this time, so that service is going to be pushed back later in the summer. So we'll let you know when that happens. Let's pray together, and then we'll sing a dismissal chorus. Lord, we thank you for the hard news that it seems like church people need to hear more than anything, that we're sinners. And we thank you for the wonderful news that of all the people on earth, you like to hang out with sinners more than anybody. So thank you for that. And we ask God that this week you'd give us the faith of Abraham to go out not knowing exactly what tomorrow will bring. And we ask God that you'd bless us to be like Matthew, who maybe even must find that the decision to follow you is more powerful than the decision to fill our own pockets, do our own thing. We thank you for these examples before us, and so many more of people who are really examples that are shining lights to us, of folks who are just walking with you. Thank you for Jesus, and thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit that goes with us now. We bless you today. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's sing together our closing chorus. Go forth in the love of God, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the peace and the presence of the Holy Spirit. Go. Amen.